Robin Beck, first time playing here at Dance Quest Radio on a Saturday evening. So if you've just joined us and you're wondering where the lovely Paul Anthony is this week, we've had a little bit of a swap around. He will be here tomorrow night as well, okay? Just because we couldn't get on last week. And I want to wish Paul a speedy recovery because he's under the weather at the moment. So more about that at some point. But just want to say, keep your chin up, mate. We're thinking of you, and don't worry. He will be on the, it'll be the Sunday party, won't it? Instead of the Saturday party. And Steve will be on after him as well. All right. So just for this week, one week only. And our lovely Helen Vi Francis, she's just messaged me to say she's in bed, not feeling 100%. Can you please let everyone know I won't be on the chat this evening? So bless her little heart. Get well. There's a lot going around. There's a lot of nasty little bugs going around out there at the moment. So before we do anything else, I think it's really exciting that we sit back and we enjoy this wonderful man, Mr. Neil Barlow, as he tells you all about how we met and how he's come up with this amazing song. It's very, very moving. Sit back and enjoy. Here's Neil Barlow. Delighted to say the gentleman I'm going to speak to in about 2 seconds, in fact he's on the phone as we speak, is the fabulous Neil Barlow, often referred to as Gary Barlow, but not that Gary Barlow, from Birmingham, and is an amazing songwriter and a gentleman that we were just talking about. And I'm trying to work out, I think I've probably known you about 12 years. Hello Neil.
Hello Sandy, how are you?
I'm all right, thank you. You?
I'm very good, thank you. Thank you for having me.
Oh, it's a pleasure. It's lovely to talk to you. You notice I referred to you as Neil and not Gary this time.
Well, it makes a change. I wish I had the talent of Gary Barlow.
You have.
And the money.
You have the money, yeah.
But there you go.
Oh, look, your other half will be saying, oi, oi, you. So how the devil are you? What have you been up to?
I'm very good, actually. Very good. Just busy. Life sort of happens and you kind of deal with the cards that are thrown at you the best that you can. And just busy working and trying to enjoy life as much as I can. And obviously still writing and recording as and when I can.
So yeah, that's brilliant, isn't it?
That's what I've been doing.
Well, we were just talking, weren't we? And we're trying to work out how long we've actually known each other. And I catapulted us back to the Christy Berg concert that we went to see with, because Neil Taylor was in it. It's too many Neils. Neil Taylor was in it. And how we met and how it sort of developed to where we are now.
Yeah, that's got to be, I mean, we worked it out. We think it's got to be around about 12 years-ish.
I know.
Probably, you know, give or take a year or so. But obviously, you knew Neil Taylor through means of of promoting his music, and Neil and I had made contact, I think, through MySpace. I think.
Oh, was
and
it?
I think so. I think it was through that, or it may have been through early days of Facebook.
I think it was.
Just trying to network through that way, and
I do have a lovely fond memory. There's a couple of fond memories of that evening, actually. The first one, which I thought was absolutely great, was that Neil Taylor came out and said, come on, come backstage. And we all piled in backstage, which is always a treat, isn't it? And Christy Berg was sat eating his dinner. Do you remember?
Yeah, it was lovely.
And I thought, oh, look, there he is. Sat. He just didn't bat an eyelid that we were there. Did we get anything to eat? I think we did. I think we had something to eat backstage.
I think it was because we went back to the hotel, didn't we?
Yeah, but we went backstage before the concert as well.
Was it the hotel after? I can't remember.
I think it was
the hotel. We went back after.
Ah.
It was back to the hotel after the gig.
Ah, okay. Secret location. Don't tell anybody.
And then I think we just stayed there till the early hours, I think.
I think we did. I remember I was chatting away, and I remember just looking across at you. That's my second fond memory, is you just sat there laughing at me. And I remember looking at you thinking, I don't know this man. I went, what are you laughing at? And you went, you're just so funny. I remember you just being quite endearing at me just being a chatterbox, because to say you're quiet isn't the right word, but you're a lot quieter than me, aren't you?
A little bit. I think when I'm in a crowded place like that, I probably just sit and observe.
Yes.
And then pick my moment. And if the moment doesn't appear, then I'll just talk when I'm spoken to, and then just enjoy the moment.
I'm quiet too.
And be present.
I'm quiet. It's like we were sitting there, and I remember like just chatting away to you, and then I remember saying, "What do you do?" And you said, "Well, I write songs." And I was like, "What? Why aren't we not interviewing you as well?" And then you said, "Well, because it actually turned out that Neil Taylor was featuring in one of your songs." So could you tell the listeners how you became this incredible songwriter and where it all started for you?
Oh, where it all started, geez. My memory's not that good. it goes back an awful long way. I think it goes back to sort of childhood, really. With me, I started writing poems when I was a child and stuff. And I think when you're going through your pubescent age and everything is a problem and nobody understands and so on and so forth. I remember writing quite a few poems back then, and I went to art college, and I was friends with a girl that was there, and she was in a band, and I started to follow that band. I went back to the recording studio with them, and I'd also, while I was still at college, there was an art teacher there who was writing and recording with a producer in somewhere up north, and I said, I'm really interested in it, would you take a look at some lyrics? And he liked the lyrics that I'd written, and he said, yeah, I'll put you in touch with this guy.
Oh, great.
And then that was my first song that I recorded.
What was it called?
Oh, that one was called Talk To You. I mean, if you listen to it now, it's a really outdated.
And now you don't like it, probably, because of...
Well, I don't mind it lyrically.
Yeah, yes.
But I think
you've moved on now.
I've moved on quite a bit, and somebody did ask me quite a few years ago, how would I do it again? I said, well, I wouldn't change it.
No.
It is what it is.
No, I like that.
Yeah, and also, like, with the writing process, somebody once asked Prince many years ago, what's your best song? What's the best song you've ever written? And his reply to that, and I agree with it, is the next one.
Oh, wow. Yeah, see, that's a little bit like in showbiz, they'll say you're only ever as good or as bad as your last performance.
Absolutely.
And that rings very true to me. So, yeah, that makes sense.
And the thing is, I have imposter syndrome an awful lot. Mm. And when it comes to songwriting, it's like, is this any good? I don't know. I really don't know. And I'll only record the ones that I think are worth investing in. Hence the reason why whenever I record, and I think it's only sort of once a year. I believe that every song that I put out or the next song that I record is always better. I always try to improve how I've written it. The song, the style of it, the production of it, I always try to improve with that, and also have Gareth, who's my co-writer and also producer as well, he always pushes me forward as well. So
that's great, isn't it?
It's always,
I don't
always
think you're alone there. I think if you look back at the history of some of the greatest songwriters or composers, Many of them are, and I can understand why you'd think, well, look, I like this, I love this, he loves this, do you like this? So, you know, we should actually mention Neil Taylor, and of course he was lead guitar with Tears for Fears and did the incredible solo for Everybody Wants to Rule the World. And now is an artist, solo artist, and doing very well in his own right. In fact, I said I haven't heard from him for a while, and you said, you know, he's just extremely busy, isn't he, all the time, so...
Yeah, he's very busy writing, producing for other artists, and also writing for other people as well. So I know he's busy. I do have contact with him, occasionally, but I need to catch up with him.
Yeah, well, you'll have to say hi from me, and if I'm free, I'll come and say hello as well. But so how did that brings me very nicely into how did you persuade Neil to get involved? I think the song we said earlier was called Lie, was it?
Yeah.
I mean, I remember we played that. So how did we get and you get, how did that all come together, look, 12 years ago?
I think with that, I love the way Neil plays. He doesn't play the typical solo that anybody would expect to hear. He has a particular style, and I remember, I mean, I'll get back to the bit that I was just about to say, but when I was writing the song and Gareth and I were producing it, I remember thinking, I need a really angry solo here, and I just thought of Neil straight away, and I just thought, you know what, if you don't ask, you don't get. And if Neil said, no, I'm incredibly busy, I don't do that kind of thing, then so be it. I've asked. And I asked him, and he said, yeah, with pleasure. And he did it. And then when he sent it back to me, it was like, wow, that's exactly what I wanted. And it fitted perfectly.
Wow, that's amazing.
Neil has an amazing style.
I would agree with you.
I was listening to something the other day, and it was from, I can't remember the artist, but I knew the guy who was playing bass on it. It was Nick Beggs, I think, from Kajagoogoo. And there was a guitar solo in it. I'm thinking, I recognise that. I don't recognise the solo, but I recognise that style. So I looked it up, and it was Neil. And I contacted Neil. I went, I've just heard this track. It's quite a few years old, but I recognise you have such a distinctive style.
Yeah.
And
He's
such a great player.
And really, he's such a lovely person as well. Yeah, and he's very easy to talk to, as you know, I've interviewed him a few times as well. And he's just, and you know, Sarchi, his wife, they're just a lovely family. And I think, you know, that really helps keeps him grounded as well.
Yeah.
Because on the straight and narrow, because obviously, you know, you hear so many stories about people that have gone on and done successful things, and it gets to their head, and next minute they're in trouble, and and all of that. So I think one of the last songs that you sent to me to allow me to play was Thank You, and I have got to tell you, I and the listeners here at Dance Quest Radio, we love that song. It is amazing, but it's not released yet, is it?
I still haven't released. That's quite old now.
How lucky are we?
Released that. Yeah, I still haven't released that yet.
Excuse me coughing, I've still got a nasty cough.
No problem. I still need to release that. It's on YouTube as for people to actually listen to, but for people to download, I've not released that yet.
No.
But maybe in the future, if I'm in thoughts of maybe releasing like an EP or something with the stuff that I've already written, just for people to download at some point, and that may be on there at some point.
See, so, there you go. Do you know what? You're such an unassuming man, because, you know, I've just sat there and said, oh, you know, we absolutely love Thank You. And you're like, yeah, not released it yet for people to download. I'm like, this song to me should be playing on, BBC Radio 2. Other stations are available. Perhaps not Radio 1, but I can hear it being on Radio 2. Have you ever considered, sending it in and just sort of seeing if somebody picks up on it, or is that not the avenue you want to go down?
It would be, but I look at people that have tried to approach Radio 2, like Neil. Again, we go back to Neil Taylor.
Yeah.
He's approached Radio 2 with his own stuff and had no success with that. And other artists that I'm aware of and I know have tried to go down that avenue of Radio 2. They've got sellout concerts and still not being played. I'm thinking, if these people can't make it, how am I going to? Again, it's the imposter syndrome. Again, you just if they're not listening to these artists, and they are artists in their own
established,
right,
they're
established artists. How is an unknown like me going to get played on Radio 2?
I'll tell you a little bit, because I think we've spoken about this before. I did do some radio blogging for Dee Anderson years ago, which involved going into places like the BBC and putting it across to them. And one of the things that they were sort of hinting to me is, they'll say the good old EMI word and things like that. And I was like, okay. And the other thing that they were talking about, and this is, for you to sort of go and look into, but they were so, like, if you get with a record company, and I thought, yeah, but will they want to change it? You know, will it be what you've written? Because that's the important thing. And the other thing then that people like EMI are looking for is how many people are listening, how many followers. It's all about the social media thing.
Absolutely. A platform. And that's it. I mean, I can't afford to pay for a plugger to go out there and do that kind of thing. And any promotion that I do, it's just me. Any videos I put out, it's me that's done it. Social media, it's me that's behind that. And obviously with a busy life anyway,
yeah.
I have to try and fit that in.
Yeah.
And I don't really know what I'm doing. I'm just
I know somebody that might be able to help you. Actually, I'm gonna have a little word with somebody and see if they get in contact with you. Well, I won't say it on the radio, but I'll tell you off the radio.
Okay.
Yeah. So I won't say any more than that. But yeah, there might be somebody that can not, you know, open the door and push you in, but guide you to the door that you need to open, if that makes sense.
Yeah, sure.
Because it's
absolutely
in this industry, whether it's acting, dancing, singing, radio, music, whatever. It's not what you know, but who you know that gets you
absolutely
to the right place to open the door to see the man that's going to go, yes, no. And that's
yeah,
the truth. That's the truth.
Yeah.
And it doesn't matter what industry you're in, actually. It's probably the same, but particularly
sure
in the good old entertainment arts world. So that brings us really nicely. Tomorrow is Mother's Day. And weirdly enough, we wanted to catch up and have a little interview. And you were kindly sending me the song that we're going to talk about. But we had a massive BT surge of the area and we couldn't get on air yesterday. So hence I'm on Saturday night. But it meant that our interview coincided with the song, and it's Mother's Day tomorrow. It's a very moving song. It's very close to my heart because obviously I lost my own mum in 2012. Tell us about Hard to Say Goodbye.
Well, I lost my mum 2 years ago. To pneumonia, and it was a very difficult experience, and very sad, and hit me like a train. It's never felt anything like it before, and I thought the only way I can help myself with this is eventually write something, which is, you know, I use writing as part of therapy. Also had therapy for the bereavement and the PTSD that I was going through with that. But with the therapy that I was having, my therapist said, you need to write a letter to your mom. And I thought, I don't know, there's so much to say, I don't know what to do. And then when I eventually came at peace with what had happened and how it happened, and I thought, okay, well, now's the time to actually write something. So I booked the studio, and I thought, okay, that's my deadline, I've got to book a studio. So I booked the Cube recording down in Cornwall to write and record with Gareth. So I did that. So I got the date ready for November, and I had got nothing. I'd written notes, but nothing was concrete. Whenever I'd go for a walk, a line would come in my head, and I'd go, right, okay, I need to write that down. So I wrote all of these notes down, and nothing was really making any sense. And the deadline was coming regarding the studio, and it's like, I need to write something, but
yeah,
I can't write when people are in
you can
house,
be, you can
you know
be,
I mean.
Yeah, you can be sort of like too emotional, and it's something,
yeah,
you've got to be completely in your own zone to let that out.
Yeah, absolutely. And the thing is, because I was at peace with my mom not being here anymore and her and whatever, I knew I had to put myself back in that place, and I knew I had to reopen that wound. So I waited until I knew the house was empty for the day. So that day came, and I basically found some old voice messages from my mom. so I listened to those.
Did you?
I looked at old messages. I got old photos, even like photos. I had a photo of Mom a couple of hours before she passed away. So I got that and I put myself back in that place and I felt awful. I think, right, okay, what do I do? How do... Well, I've only got a maximum of 4 minutes to fill. I can't do a tribute because there's too much to say. What do I do? And I thought, well, okay, I'm going to do it from the moment of the phone call. That's the moment. That's the moment from...
And I get that
My world literally fell apart from that call.
Yeah.
And the song is literally my journey from that call to being, not being at peace, but basically going through the emotions of losing my mom within those 2 days.
And it's coming to terms with it. It's that realization that it's final, and that's only when you've lost a parent, and I've lost both now, that you realize that it's final, and it's, you know.
Well, that's what I've tried to cover in the song, and what I've done is that I've tried to cover every emotion that's in there, and also with the production of it as well, because there's the calm, there's the hope, there's the desperation, there's the anger, then there's the oh, okay, you're still around, and then anger again, and then at the end it's nothing, and hence the reason why it's, when you hear it, there's a sudden end, and there's a whoosh at the end, which is final.
Yeah.
And it's got absolutely everything in it.
One could almost say it's the spirit leaving the body. It's that sort of feeling for me, anyway, when I heard it.
Yeah, it's. I tried to cover everything
clever.
With it, and
it's very clever.
We've managed to do it, and it's a very powerful, hard hitting song. And if anybody hears it, I kind of put a warning out there to say.
Be warned, it's emotional. What happened yesterday, I heard it, and the first thing I said to you is, I'm in tears, because it hit every note for me of how I felt about my own mum. And I think that's what it is. You relate to your own experience through your hurt and pain, and you go, it's almost like, oh, this is going to sound really ridiculous comparison, right, so forgive me, but you know when Peter Kay used to say, put the big light on, or who's this calling at this time of night? And you suddenly realise that everybody in the country had said, put the big light on, or who's this calling when the phone rang. And it's that, for me, it was that experience of every word you said, I related to it.
Yeah.
And that's why I think it's a masterpiece to me.
The thing is with this one, this is a really, I was really anxious and very nervous about releasing this. Because it's a really, I have literally opened every pore into this, and it's a very, very personal song. And
it must feel very strange when other people will contact you and say, I can relate to everything you've just said there, because you want to sort of go, no, this is my personal experience. And you don't realise that everybody else has gone that's gone through that is... thinking you've written this about their mum or dad. It's quite weird.
But that's the lovely thing about it, is the fact that this is very personal to me, and this is my story. Mm. And when I played it to my sister, and I've also played it to my dad as well, I said, look, this is my journey. Mm. You have a different experience of what you have a different experience of mum. And my partner Ange was with me when my mom passed away, and I said, your experience is different, but this is my story, so please bear with me. And it's a very open song for me, but when I'm getting feedback like yourself, and also messages back, whether it be a voicemail or whether it be beautiful messages on Facebook or whatever, it is so heartwarming to know that, you know what, I'm glad that this has touched somebody else. I don't feel so alone with this emotion. I don't feel so alone with this.
I'm really pleased about that, actually. And I tell you, your mum would be so proud. I mean, it's a bit, you know, I don't want to tip on it too much. I don't want to set you off because I know things can set people off. I get that as well. But, you know, I said to you yesterday, she's very proud of you, and there's an extra star shining tonight when we play it and things like that. And, of course, it's Mother's Day tomorrow, and I think it's just a brilliant day for our listeners to hear it.
No, I hope so. You know, we all have our own beliefs in whatever, and I think she, you know, if she was to hear this, then I think she'd like it. When I was nervous when I played it to my dad, because I released this on February the 11th this year, and that was the anniversary of my mom passing away. So I went to, Ange and I went to my dad's, and we stayed the weekend, and we were there that weekend of the anniversary, and I played it to dad that day, because I thought there's no right time to play this, but I didn't want my dad to hear this on his own, because again, it would, you know, evoke
trigger him off.
Emotions and stuff, and I don't want him to be on his own when he does that. Mm. He heard it. And I was in the room with him, and he said, "That's the best thing you've ever written."
Oh, isn't that lovely? Isn't that lovely? You couldn't ask for better than that, really. So, who's actually singing the song? And you co-wrote it with Gareth. Tell us about the team with you, because they're important.
Basically, when I went down to the studio, I got the lyrics, and it was a starting point. The main structure of the song was there, and I'd sit down with Gareth, and Gareth would be on the piano, and we'd work out a structure, and then he'd go, okay, I need more lyrics for that. I'm going to leave the studio, write some more lyrics for that, because it needs to fill. So I'd do that, and then he'd come back, and then Gareth would do like a guide vocal on there. And then we'd structure it out and get it all done and ready for the lead vocal to come in. Now, we have worked with Josh Curnow before on two other of my tracks, and Josh is a superb singer and an artist in his own right. He's been a semi-finalist for Britain's Got Talent.
Yes.
And he's just a superb singer. And unfortunately, the weekend that it was being recorded, he had got COVID, so he couldn't come into the studio while I was there. So it was, we'd done the recording, and we'd done all these different layers on music, instruments, and so on and so forth. So I had to wait for Josh to actually come and do the vocals. But on the guitars as well, I've got a guy called Chris Haddon on there. Now, he was in the studio at the same time. Now, he's Tom Meehan's guitarist, who is ex-Kasabian, and he's also guitarist for Toby Lee, who's a superb, I think he's 18 now, he's a superb blues guitar
That's
player.
That's amazing, isn't it?
Superb.
Love that.
But he's
it's got the right connections guitars. Then, hasn't it, really?
Yeah, he plays guitars on this track. So two or three weeks later, Josh then went in to do the vocals. Now, I couldn't be there, but how we did this was I was at work, and I did it during my lunch break. So I sat somewhere very, very quiet in an office on my own, and we did a video link to the vocal booth that was in the studio and also the current control room as well. So I could hear Josh doing the vocals and also direct him as best as I could.
Yeah.
Within the time that I got.
Yeah.
And it blew me away. Absolutely blew me away. So it was like done in like two or three takes, obviously.
Well, that's a professional for you, isn't it?
But doing that and then having to go back to compose myself and then go back to work, because when you do write stuff, it's great when it's written down on paper, and then the thing just comes to life, and that is when it hits you. It really hits hard. Yeah. And that hit me hard, and it's like, I need to compose myself. I need to go back to work and act like nothing has happened. And did that. And then two weeks, maybe 3 weeks later, I got the final mixes back from Gareth, and it's like, wow, this is amazing. And that really hit me hard.
Then you realise you've got something now. You've got a new baby to release, and it's complete. And it's It's always amazed me how things just suddenly just all come together. It's just quite extraordinary, I think.
Yeah, it does. And this came together really well. I mean, Gareth is a master at his art. He's just a superb writer, producer, multi-instrumentalist. He's just a genius.
You're pretty good yourself, you know, Neil.
I put pen to paper, that's all I do.
Oh, is that all? Yeah. I just put a few words down. It's nothing great. I do that too. I write lots of words down, but they don't turn into a great song.
I've got a good team behind me, so that's certainly what helps. And I've heard the song quite a few times now, and it depends on what mood I'm in. Some days it's just another song, but some days, like you say, it triggers, and the emotions hit again, and I'm sure that, like I said earlier, if anybody has suffered bereavement, this I think will touch them.
It will indeed, and it's a beautiful song to play for Mothering Sunday. So, would you like to introduce your own song here on Dance Quest Radio, please, Neil Barlow?
I'll give it a go.
Thanks,
right, this is my new release. It's called Hard to Say Goodbye.
Fantastic. We're going to listen to it now, and I just want to wish you all the very best with it. And thank you for popping on and letting us know about the new song. Thank you, darling.
My absolute pleasure. Thank you.
Come back and let us know how it goes, won't you?
Yeah, we'll do.
All right, darling. Thank you.
I've been dreading, son, you might want to make your way home. Your mother might not make it through the night. It was the longest drive of my life, hoping I'd make it in time. Mother, please keep up your fight. Don't want to make this our last day. There's so much more to say. Help me find a way. I don't want to lie. Please don't leave us all behind. I don't want to face this our last day. It's so hard to say goodbye to the first love, love of my life. You were there for my first breath. I held your hand for your last goodbye. I'm left with the memories of the past. It's so hard, so hard. How to say goodbye. How to say goodbye. I selfishly wanted you to stay, but I knew it couldn't be that way. I never imagined my life without you. Now that your fighting is done, you're no longer hanging on. I'm gonna miss those days when you call. There's so much more to say. Help me find a way. I don't wanna lie. Please don't leave us all behind. I don't wanna face this our last day. It's so hard to say goodbye.
Incredible song that is. That's just taken me a little minute to come on and just speak. The incredible Neil Barlow. Wasn't he amazing to be able to come on and talk about something so sensitive and just absolutely wow everybody with Hard to Say Goodbye featuring Josh Curnow. Semi-finalist, I think, for Britain's Got Talent and the wonderful work of Gareth down there in Cornwall. Thank God you all got together. And Kasabian as well. Absolutely incredible. And I think if that doesn't get out there as a song on its own right, then there's something very, very wrong with the music industry. Thanks, Trev. So some of the comments for you, Neil, are coming in. Trev saying, wow. Angela's saying, what a beautiful song. Olivia says, that should be a hit. The Chopper Squad has said, it's been a long time since I've listened to a song and loved it from beginning to end. And I love the way that it builds and the passion in that song. It's just incredible. Congratulations. And I look forward to you contacting me one day and telling me that, you know, it's a big hit. I've done it before. I'll say it again. And this is the truth. That song should be a number one. Whether it's not in the UK, America, somewhere, it's going to be number one. There's my prediction. It's incredible. And of course, Neil Barlow's provided us with other songs as well, like Thank You, which I can just sit there and go, I just want to thank you, which he dedicated to his beautiful partner. Absolutely beautiful. It's so lovely. I want to hear it again. But I've got the Rock Shop, where the Rock Shop rocks on its way with Dead Daisies this week. And we do all love our mums, but whether you've lost a mum, dad or anybody close, that song means something to us all, doesn't it? Well done, mate. Love it. Look forward to seeing you soon.